Okay.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kimberly Furman, and I am the Revit Community Manager. I am very excited for today's Inside the Factory Ask Me Anything, because we are talking generative design and computation. And this takes my nerd level to an all-time high. As you can see, I've got Fido behind me. And I also have the team from Generative Design, from Dynamo, on the call with us. We're going to give everybody a minute or two to continue to log in, and then we're going to go ahead and get started. So check out the backgrounds. They are some really cool stuff. I think we've got some Quidditch going on. Is that right, Jacob? In Jacob's background.
Yeah, this is from the generative design at Hogwarts AU session I did last year. It's from the optimal layout of the Quidditch World Cup.
And that is
associated
awesome.
Grounds. So
I'm going to have to go check that one out for sure. That's great. All right. So we'll give everybody probably another minute or so, and then we'll go ahead and get started. In the meantime, in the background, we've got David Smolker and Aaron Vorwerk in the background getting ready to take your questions. So feel free to put those into the chat window at any time, and we'll go ahead and get started. So as I said, today we're exploring the world of generative and computational design. We have a few members of the generative design Dynamo and computation team ready to take your questions related to features and improvements in new development. So I'm going to let them introduce themselves. I'm going to ask them each a question, actually two questions, and just let them tell you a little bit about themselves. So I'm going to start off with Saul because he's in my upper left corner. So Saul, the questions are, we just had a major release of software. And so what was your favorite feature in this last release of either Revit or Dynamo? And what are you excited about that's coming up on the roadmap?
So hello, everyone. My name's Saul. I'm really excited about the introduction of Python 3. Inside of Dynamo, so you can get that in Revit 2022, actually 2021.1 onwards. Really excited for the possibilities that brings to the space, the access to all of the really fun libraries that work in sort of the Python 3 realms, such as machine learning, applicable technologies. So super excited about that. And what's upcoming, I'm really excited for a Dynamo visual refresh. So we're looking at reinventing and modernizing the Dynamo UI and experience, particularly focusing on documentation and the ability for you to spend your time efficiently and effectively within the piece of software. So excited for that.
Great, thank you. And Zach, same questions.
Thanks. The big ones are the sort of the ongoing commitment that we've had to sort of stability and performance increases. So it's kind of like, I'm still excited about the things that we did before because we keep doing that of increasing stability, increasing performance, just because it affects everybody. Dynamo implementations in Revit and Format and Advanced Steel and Robot Structural Analysis and Alias, and I'm forgetting some, but all of them are going to benefit from those kinds of increases and just sort of the ongoing commitment to that. So that's also going to be the thing that I'm excited about next time. So that's sort of a cheat answer. The other one that I would actually add also about generative design in Revit is the increased ability to sort of share, sort of package up stuff so that, you know, it works on my machine and now it can work on your machine too.
That's great. Thank you. All right, Lily.
Hi, everyone. Lily Smith. I'm a product manager responsible for generative design in Revit. And now our teams are also taking on responsibility for Dynamo Player. So all the things that use Dynamo in the back end having some UI that hopefully more users can start to use computational tools on top of their Dynamo logic. So I, like Zach, I'm also very excited about the performance improvements when you're making so many things and running Dynamo so many times. Performance really matters. Really happy with the sharing tools that came out with Revit 2022. As Zach was saying, getting my logic onto your machine is now a lot easier. And going forward, really looking forward to being able to export all of these outcomes so that people can tell the story of their design in many, many different ways, that people are doing all kinds of exciting things with Power BI, with Excel, with making all kinds of their own assets and talking about their designs backed by the data analytics that they're able to generate.
Awesome. Thank you, Lily. And finally, Jacob.
Beyond the sharing and the Python 3 goodness that everybody else picked up, I think I'm most excited for with the current release and the stuff that's coming in the future, what the end users are going to do with this great tool. It's one of those things where every time I see a new tool launched, it takes like a year, year and a half before we start to see those results actually out in the field in terms of what happens. And we're just about at that time. So I'm really excited to see some of this stuff start to get built.
Awesome. All right. Well, before we get started with the questions, just a few housekeeping things to consider. Today, we're focusing on the roadmap update for generative and computational design. We ask that you keep your questions generally related to the roadmap. Of course, the biggest question is always when. When is something going to be added to the software? When is it going to be added to the roadmap? And honestly, we just can't answer that question. So if you start a question with the word when, it probably won't be answered. However, we will try to answer as many of your questions as possible. We're going to, like I said, be fielding those between David and Aaron. They'll be sending those to me, and I'll be giving those to our panelists. Aaron and David, I hope you're ready, and I think we're good to go. Also, this session is being recorded. It will be available on the YouTube channel afterwards. So we have a question from our customer base that we received before the session. This one's for Zach. How will the acquired Spacemaker technology be integrated with Dynamo and generative design or other future Autodesk products?
Great question. Thank you, Paul. And yeah, I saw that this question had come up on some of the chats earlier before. Spacemaker is one of the reasons that, you know, they're part of Autodesk right now is that they're already doing a lot of the things that are sort of part of our longer term roadmap in terms of getting people data about their designs as they're doing it. And helping it sort of inform the design changes that they're going to do, as well as looking at not just singular designs, but sort of given some outputs that you want, what are the different kind of possible designs that you could have to get there? So part of the answer is that a lot of the capabilities are already there in Spacemaker in terms of saying, can I look at options? Can I understand why one is better than another? Make a decision to go with one over another. So that's a little bit of the evasive answer is because it's not specifically about, you know, generative design in Revit or Dynamo, but it is about the same kind of capabilities that are already there in a tool in Spacemaker. A lot of the work that's going on right now is understanding how those sort of very, very early stage designs for Spacemaker can migrate into sort of the detailed design phase. So, you know, you're going to start seeing some of the work that's happening there. The customization is going to come a little bit later, but the primary stuff is to start really getting into that idea of how can we make it so that sort of outcome-driven design or sort of knowing what the data is that is associated with your design decisions is available to more people. Because right now it has a relatively sort of small base of users that have been sort of targeted towards real estate. And we are looking more to sort of how we can get that out to more designers.
Okay, great. So our questions are coming in rather slowly. Don't forget to put those into the chat window there in YouTube. But I have a question for you all coming, and this probably is going to be directly to Lily because she has buildings behind her. But I come from an architectural background. So I've designed buildings and seen buildings coming up out of the ground. As an architect, how does generative design help me? This all seems very kind of futuristic, but it's really happening right now.
Yeah. So we think that it's, you know, generative design, people working using computers to help them design things has been really an idea that's been around for decades. But it really hasn't been very accessible for people. We think that it's really exciting when you can combine metrics and math, simple math that you can do with your building's designs and being able to use the computer to help you tweak things slightly so that you can, you know, you wouldn't want to do all those tiny tweaks by yourself and those resultant measurements. But if you can use the computer to help you do that, you can really survey a much bigger quantity of designs. In the building, in the example I have behind me, I'm actually using solar analysis. So looking at how much solar energy a surface of the building is getting to help guide those designs.
That's fantastic. I can definitely see how this would be helpful in the architectural field, and I'm sure many other fields as well. We do have a couple of questions coming in now. And so I'm going to say, maybe this is a question for Jacob. Why can't I hide void elements?
So when I first read that question, it sounds like the geometry has been produced as a preview of the geometry elements from Dynamo rather than the actual Revit content. So if you click on it and you can't grab it and it looks like it's a blue outline and sort of orange faces that you can't really see sort of the internal faces, only the silhouette gets that blue outline, that's likely the Dynamo geometry preview showing up in Revit. The fix for that is going to be right-clicking on the node that produces the geometry and disabling the geometry preview by just right-clicking, going into the preview section, and turning that off.
Great.
So hopefully that'll clear that up without too many more issues.
Yeah, we actually had two questions related to that one. So I hope that definitely answers the question. We had one, and let me see if I can find it here. Sorry about this. Bifocals just get me every time. There is a comment from Alan that says, and Zach, this is, will be directed to you. We're interested in creating the most efficient module sizes in curtain walls. Can you help out?
Sure. And this doesn't necessarily have to be a computation one or a generative design one. There are solutions that we can definitely jump in on for that one. And the starter question for that is, you know, can you define what is efficient? And you know, with a lot of these questions, like whether or not you do it with a computational method or not, having an idea of what you think success looks like is sort of a big one. And so with curtain module sizes, it's like, is it that you have as many modules that are the same? Is it that they stay within a certain barrier of, you know, they can't be any bigger than some aspect, or that they can be within a tolerance for something? There are a bunch of routines that I've seen in Dynamo and in generative design that basically start from a point of view of, you know, generating a number of panel options and then measuring them against some of those criteria. And then you can grade them based on that. And I believe there's at least two AU classes I can think of. And maybe after this question, I'll go and see if I can find them. One is by Dieter Vermeulen on panelization. And another one is by John Pearson on panelization techniques. And there are these variations on going through and saying, you know, what happens if I have, you know, 15 divisions versus 20 divisions in different directions? And how does that come out with having things that are either more alike or within a tolerance closeness to each other? So sorry, there's kind of a lot to sort of dig into in that question. If you want to add any more specifics into that, happy to sort of give it another shot later on in this program.
Great, thank you. So this one, I think we're going to direct to Saul at first, and maybe someone else can jump in on this as well. How would you promote or help people to join the use of this tech, which is also so big in terms of conditions and possibilities? So from both a Dynamo and a generative design perspective.
Perfect. So thank you for the question, Sam. First of all, like you mentioned, so there is infinite possibilities really with building your own logic and building your own routines. And you are the person who kind of sets that, but to jump into the deep end is kind of a little bit daunting in the first place. So what we've created is a Dynamo primer, which is sort of your one-stop shop to start from knowing absolutely nothing about Dynamo and then getting to a place where you can build some functioning graphs and do some really cool things. But generally speaking, usually the best way to get into it in tandem with the Dynamo primer is just to find a problem that you can sink your teeth into, because it's the context of what you're trying to achieve that actually matters the most. So when you start to understand the problem space and start to understand what you're trying to solve, it's a really good hook to use to try and understand how to jump into a piece of technology. So if you find a problem that's salient to your particular project and you use the primer to help you get there, as well as leverage things like the forums and a bunch of other places, you will find the help that you need on this front. And we're going to be posting a link in the chat to a bunch of different resources here that help you and will help you on your Dynamo journey. Some of these are targeted at sort of the more beginner landscape, such as the Dynamo primer. The Dynamo blogs, for example, start to explain what happens in the Dynamo ecosystem. But there's also some more advanced places as well, so like the location of Dynamo wish lists, where you can place your requests for ideas and features to get added to Dynamo, and things like Dynamo GitHub, which is actually where we physically build, where we build the code that makes Dynamo, and you can go and have your 2 cents on that space too. So there's a bunch of wikis and issues and sort of submissions of code to that space. So very cool. Please do check out the link, the resources link, and please do engage on the forum. There's a lot of really, really passionate people in this space who really just want to help. And so you almost always get an answer to the question that you have. People like Jacob basically live in that space. So thanks, Jacob. Big shout out on that one.
Great. Thank you, Saul. Lily, this one is for you. Will we be able to change or modify edit inputs in Dynamo Player instead of node creation order?
That is a question that we get from a lot of people. So it's frustrating right now, I know, when you're making a routine and for Dynamo Player and the inputs come in order that is very hard to tell what it is. And you can go in and monkey with the Dynamo file to change that, but that's hard. So yes, we are looking at doing that. We've been considering things like using groups, using order actually in the Dynamo file itself, looking at being able to see the player UI before you in a editing mode and being able to change that. We're looking at taking a lot of the, this is a problem with the generative player, which I'll call like the create study for generative design right now as well. But we're looking at doing a lot of merging between the generative player and the Dynamo player. And we definitely want to fix issues like the order of inputs as we do that. So stay tuned.
And well, yeah, while you're unmuted, here is another question from Reza. Hello, are we going to see more study types coming up in the generative design package? And to what extent these studies are editable? Can we modify them in Dynamo as we want?
Yes. So in Revit 2022, which we just released, we do have some updated study types and some new study types. And there is now an edit button where you can go and directly from the create study, look at what those are doing in Dynamo. And yes, definitely edit them, save them as something else. I guess my question would be back to you is, are those study types useful for learning? Because it's difficult for us to make things that are very generally usable across a wide, wide range of different design problems that our software serves. So we'd love to hear from people what kinds of samples they'd like to see more, what would be helpful. We do try to also publish some on an ongoing basis on the Dynamo blog and on the Generative Design Primer to give people ideas and starting point scripts for what they can do.
Thank you. The next one for Jacob. Shouldn't there be more tutorials on space planning?
Yeah, this is a tough one. Everybody you talk to wants to get into space planning with generative, and every time you start to say, okay, well, what's your process? If I was to manually sit you down and say, manually lay out a building, what's your process? How do you sort of make the decisions in terms of where pieces go? How do you define not just the relationships between adjacent spaces, but what makes a good spatial layout? Is so varied that it's really tough to have one example that sort of sits well. I do want to try and set aside some of my personal time to get a few more studies published out, because in all my travels, every time I come to somebody and we talk about it, it's like, okay, well, there's that thing that's consistently needed yet again. And, you know, I might get some stuff published up to the generative primer or other sources in the near future. No promises made, but as much as I can get out there, I will, even if it means I'm paying a little less attention to the Dynamo form, perhaps for a couple of weeks.
We do have a recent blog post on some space planning tools from Long Nguyen on DynaShape that you can check out. It's not going to solve all space planning problems for sure, but it could be an interesting avenue to learn. I'll put that in the chat too.
Great. That's good to know, Lily. Thank you. And thank you, Jacob. So an update from a previous question, Samuel asked for a little bit of clarification on his technology question. I wonder if it's worth addressing how you get clients to understand the value. And I guess Saul already addressed this on YouTube, but did you want to make a comment about that?
Yeah, so my question, I guess, back to you, Samuel, is like, are you looking to sell sort of GD and Dynamo services as a new sort of service offering at your company? Or are you more looking to use the language inside of your own sort of internal processes and just talk to customers or talk to clients about that? So I guess I'd be shooting that one back to you for a little bit of clarification and we can talk about it.
Okay. And it looks like he just responded, hoping to start selling generative design as a service for companies. So the issue, as far as explained, to make clients understand the value of it. Okay. And I'm happy to sort of jump in on that one. I mean, or Lily?
Go for it. I'll add.
Okay, sure. So I think a lot of the way that we talk about sort of generative design as a process, as well as sort of a technology, starts with everybody getting on the same page about what your goals are. And one of the ways that you can start sort of engaging clients with this is to say, there is this exciting technology that's coming out that will, if we can correctly deploy it, we can start getting higher performance buildings for your needs, client. And then it starts by sitting down with the client and saying, let's go over the goals that you have for this project and put sort of to the best of the degree that we can put some metrics on it to say, what does success look like? So how would we measure success? And that conversation itself, we have found to be something that like sort of everybody will sit in a room and say like, of course, that makes sense. But then the actual conversations don't always happen with the clients. And to sort of make that sort of an explicit part of the process to say, let's sit down and let's get, you know, this can be a little freaky for people. It's to say, let's put numbers on what better looks like. And then making that part of a conversation that then feeds into a technological process, which can actually help you get to those numbers. You can get to those numbers lots of different ways, but using something like generative design and Revit can be a process that's explicitly set up to say, this is what we said success looks like. And then you go through the process and you come up with these different numbers with things that meet those success. And very often we find that the client and the designer will sort of sit down and say like, ah, well, this is what we thought success looked like. And then we found some other things along the way. And so it's really about sort of engaging in that process of saying, getting some objectives that are measurable. Lily, I don't know if you wanted to add to that.
Yeah, idea. I mean, I think you can't underestimate the value of you know, we do it with OKRs, with objectives and key results, and trying to put measurable numbers on what we're trying to achieve. And just having that discussion can be, and bringing those people together to have that discussion can be a huge benefit to your design. And then, you know, using the computer to help you make these modifications and study them is another huge benefit. Although I'll say that you know, just using the computer to make tons of options isn't going to help you unless you have good metrics to sort through those options and help you optimize for the best thing. So that, that beginning conversation is critical, and then using those metrics to guide you and really, you know, use the data for what it is and what it's telling you to help guide your design. And then I would also say picking problems that are high value adds value to what you're studying with generative design. We see people who are doing like huge dry dock layouts, like where should my ship channel go so that I don't have to, the cut and fill operations that I'm doing are going to save millions of dollars if I turn this road a little bit this way, it's going to save me so much money. There's architecture problems too that are very beneficial to study this way. I mean, I think some of the facade problems, looking at panelization, can be something that you can set up pretty quickly and has a lot of value. I don't know. Anything else you want to add, Jacob, to that?
I think the key piece is as owners start to get smarter about what they're looking for in their building, it's going to be driven more on, did you meet the metric of what I hired you to meet? Not just, is there enough desks for everybody to sit, but is it the right quality of space? And without having a way to quantify what you think that is in advance, that's going to be really tough to do. Even if you were to lay it out manually, one of the first examples of generative I ever put together was the residential space planning piece, right? Where it just takes a single hallway and lays out rooms on either side of that hallway. And that worked out really well. And then the end result, like, I don't like the shape of those rooms. Can we tweak this? Can we tweak that so that, you know, we don't have a dead end hallway or something like that? And as I started to, you know, you start to do that, you might change the outcome of the score because you tweak stuff. So taking that same evaluator and applying it after the fact will also give you some value in your process.
Great discussion, everyone. Thank you so much for that input. I'm going to direct this one to Saul. Maybe he's not the right person, but he's been really quiet up there in the corner. So if Autodesk didn't focus on basic modeling, how will people get comfortable with generative design? Revit basic adaptive models need a major overhaul because most users want to control them at a basic level.
Right, interesting question, first of all. I would say that Autodesk has some basic modeling capabilities and pieces of software such as Format. And if you haven't heard of Format, please do go check it out. It also has a really interesting Dynamo integration. So you can do some really cool things in there. In terms of getting comfortable with anything, any of these technologies such as Dynamo or generative design, then we do have these primers, which is basically, like I mentioned earlier, a way to handhold you all the way through from knowing nothing to getting to a place of success. And so, as I also mentioned earlier, finding a salient problem to dig into is also a really good hook to get you sort of, you know, eager and excited to learn on how to solve that kind of problem. In terms of the Revit specific question, I think we have to throw that one back to the Revit team when it comes to adaptive components. It's not something that's really within our remit here today, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you, Saul. This one's going to go back to Zach. How do you see Autodesk Spacemaker and Autodesk Generative Design working together?
Sure. Didn't we? Well, okay, sure. I can do it again.
Sort of. That was from our very own Scott Davis, so you can go back to him on this one.
All right. Hey, Scott. On one hand, I think what we were talking about before was that in a lot of ways, it's already there. There's for the experience, like, so, you know, the, you know, sort of a, it's like a convergent evolution thing. The generative design process is already a part of the experience in Spacemaker. That is, you know, when you specify certain outcomes that you want and certain basic constraints for the design that you're working with, it is part of the Spacemaker experience to begin to offer up alternatives and options for you. You know, one of the big differences between these two environments, just to sort of push this conversation a little bit further, is that generative design in Revit was very specifically and purposely built as an open-ended framework that you can come to it with your problems and you can construct solutions for those things. That makes it a little bit more complicated in order to sort of get into, because it does allow for many, many different kinds of problems to be solved within that sort of optimization routine. And what Spacemaker has is that Spacemaker is offering a very early stage design for really multifamily residential in a few areas, and then optimization within some spaces that are defined by that platform, which, you know, this is sort of a regular trade-off in the software between, do you have a constrained space for the design problem that you're solving? And if so, we can actually make more sort of out-of-the-box solutions for it. If you're in a sort of an open-ended area, you probably need to do more customization. So you can sort of experience generative design in those two spaces right now, and that sort of different kind of level of customizability. We do see that stuff sort of converging in the future, where you're going to be able to sort of have more modules that are sort of more custom built for particular problems, and still having the sort of open-ended frameworks going forward.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, Zach. The next question from, and I'm sorry if I butcher the name, Rishab, is, I'm going to direct this to Jacob, I believe. Any question or any plans to support automated building code check in Revit? Partial coverage to begin with.
I think long term, that's probably a question for the Revit team rather than the generative team. I don't have any more insights than anybody else might have on that, but I can say you can do a lot of your building code evaluation and analysis through automation means, such as, you know, Dynamo, or you could program, you know, once you know what those limits are and you wanted to do, I don't know, space planning, you could then evaluate the resulting graph or the resulting shape against that same check. So it's, again, this idea that Zach just kind of got to, you know, where generative design is sort of open source, build your own. As you build your own, you can start to grab different parts and modules to sort of make sure that that works. So there would be some value. Building code as a metric, though, or as an evaluation, is extremely difficult because the building codes are in no way standard. You can drive 15 minutes and go through three different building codes, which means you need three different algorithms to evaluate and three different charts. And how do you even pick that initial chart to start with? It can be really, really difficult.
I would add to that. It isn't necessarily that they're all difficult; it's that they're all different. And as a global provider of solutions to people all over the planet, it's hard for Autodesk to sort of do those sort of hyper-local solutions. And so any one of those individual decisions may actually not be that complicated to implement, but they do need to be implemented differently in all of those different locations, especially for things like local building code.
Yeah, I'd add to that too. I'd say that what is really useful though is, like, people do routines inside of Dynamo that do sort of Revit QA QC on their model. So one way to start sort of getting to a space where you can do that better and faster is using an automated solution that helps you clean up your model and make sure it's sort of, you know, cooking with gas, so to speak, before you even go down the path of trying to model check. And as both Jacob and Zach have said, you can create routines yourself if you want to. Dynamo is specifically designed for you to be able to do that, to do model checking. If you were working within the same jurisdiction again and again, that might be something worth investing in for sure. But as already mentioned, for us, the nuance associated with that means it's very difficult for us to build a generalized solution.
Yeah, that sounds like an interesting and complex, I don't want to say problem, but situation, I think. It's, you know, do you design to code to begin with, or do you go back and see if your design fits the code, you know, which comes first? So thank you all for your responses to that one. I'm going to direct this one to Lily, I believe. As an MEP engineer, I always wanted to use space planners to place individual components in a complex room, like a mechanical room. Do you have any inspirational videos or AU sessions for Ricard?
I did post one in the chat. Sean Fruin is one of our very dedicated and very excited about MEP and generative And he actually started a company to help people do this too. So you can check out him, and he has a lot of great classes at AU as well. I put one example in the chat. But yeah, I think MEP is a really, really interesting area for generative, and talk about like making little tweaks and figuring things out. I think, you know, the computer can really help with that. And it's an area that we haven't been focused on as much as we'd like to, because our teams have just been asked to focus on architecture workflows for the sake of focusing. But MEP is definitely a very interesting area to explore.
Kind of along the same lines, Lily, Marcel asks, any tips related to facilities management? It's high in demand in Holland, and maybe the next live chat that we have, maybe we can focus on facilities management. How do you see this being a factor in that?
Yeah, I haven't talked to a lot of people about using facilities management, generative and facilities management. But I know that there's a lot of people at Autodesk who are interested in monitoring spaces and, you know, tracking how spaces actually perform and using that data back in how you're developing metrics to guide new building design. I don't know, Zach or Jacob, you have anything to add in the more specifically?
I haven't seen it, but as soon as you say it, I start to think, well, what does facility planners want to optimize for? Okay, how hard is it to change the piece out? How often do I have to change the piece out? What's the best way to sort of schedule this long-term? And all of those things could be taken in even at the initial schematic phase, right? Like I'm thinking I've got a massive, you know, the ugliest flat 2x4 ceiling grid in the world, and I've got 100,000 light bulbs in it, right? And like a warehouse sort of situation. How do I go through and figure out what's the best way to, you know, sort of pick out light bulbs or light fixtures so that the ease of change out, the speed or the frequency of change out and everything else plus price could of that change out aspect could inform the design directive early on. So it's definitely some potential, but I haven't seen any uses just yet.
Zach and Crawley McCrone also did some really interesting studies looking at existing office building configurations of furniture and looking at how you might lay it out or how you might occupy them at 50% or 30% for COVID for, and, you know, without throwing out all your furniture, how do you bring people back at a certain, you know, less occupancy level? And that was a really interesting study to use the computer to help you, you know, either do, like we talked to Yale about looking at, you know, their 300 buildings on their campus, and could you automate how to look at occupancy for each of those buildings? Some of those were really interesting studies. Zach, do you wanna?
Well, I just was gonna run back a little bit towards the question that I think kicked a lot of this off as the MEP engineer looking for placing individual components in complex rooms is that just because it is big and complex doesn't necessarily actually mean that you need to have optimization part of it. It could be, but it just, I want to just sort of add in there's sort of a progression of like, if you know that there's a specific kind of success for a project of saying like, I know that in every room that is of X size, I need to have a system put into that room that is Y size. That can actually be sort of a straight line automation. And we kind of talk about it, at least internally and to some degree externally, about the difference between sort of automation and optimization. So with automation, it's like, I know where I need to get to and I just need to get there faster. And so for things like placing objects in lots of different rooms, it's a big problem, it's a complex problem, but it might actually have a very straightforward path of like, first find all the rooms that are X size and then place in this element in them. And then find the next room that's the next size and place X elements in them. In the situation where there's lots of different good answers, but you're looking for the best one or a better one, That's where you can get into the sort of the trade-off routines of saying, you know, well, all of these are adequate answers, but I want to get a better answer. That's where you can sort of up the game a little bit into the optimization routines. So all of this is just to sort of say a caution against jumping in feet first with like trying to make everything a multi-objective optimization problem, because they aren't all. But we can use similar tools to solve both kinds of problems.
That's a good point. And thank you for clarifying between automation and optimization. That's very helpful for sure. Okay, so let's see. Saul is going to take this one. It feels like there are at least three layers or levels to generative design in Dynamo: graphs, Python, and lastly, C nodes. Do you recommend one approach over the other when learning generative design?
So I know this is a generative question, so Lily, you're probably going to have thoughts on this too, but it's also a Dynamo question, generally speaking. So I would say that there is multiple different layers to Dynamo, if you want to express it that way. So first of all, you have some out-of-the-box nodes. That's everything that we ship, and you can use that to your heart's content. Those are actually expressed expressions of design script in C Sharp. So there's a little bit of nuance to that. But basically, the levels that get beyond using the out-of-the-box content is either Python, which is basically in-graph content. So if you want to use a scripting method, such as Python, you can do that either in-graph with Python, or you can use that out of graph with C Sharp if you want to build your own nodes and ship those along to the end user of that graph itself. So if you wanted to have all of your code being visible and accessible to people, Python is a very good way to do that. It means that people can jump in the graph and actually understand what you're trying to do, especially if you're very good at documenting and commenting out your code lines. And if you wanted to have that information to be a little bit more sort of closed, in this case, maybe you want to protect your IP, you could ship that as a C-sharp node. That way it's sort of wrapped up inside of this box and the functionality is still there and still useful, but it is shipped in a kind of slightly different way. So it's kind of two different angles. There are sort of many different sort of pros and cons when it comes to using those kind of things. I personally navigate towards or move towards Python because I think it's really cool to have everything in graph and have people be able to inspect that and see what is going on. And part of the sharing economy or community with inside of Dynamo is really born by the passion of everybody willing to share and add content. And so Dynamo's strength in many ways has come from the early adopters of Dynamo in the space, sharing their content in Python to expand the capabilities of what Dynamo can do. So to loop this back to GD, all of those layers are in Dynamo itself. And then GD builds a couple more layers on top of that, which Lily can probably speak to.
Yeah, I mean, I would say the first thing to figure out is what problem are you trying to solve? And then figure out what do you need to know to figure out that problem? You know, and yes, there are a lot of resources out there that can help you. I mean, I have an architecture background and I am not very good at Python. And I use other people's Python nodes, but I mainly am using them just with their Dynamo wrappers. And I can go in and plug in Dynamo nodes to each other and do things like solar analysis studies. But you know, sometimes I need help. I go to Jacob. He makes me some nodes, and I put them in there. Or Autodesk Research makes pretty cool packages to experiment with. I don't know, Jacob, how would you answer that question?
I think I swing back towards more sort of Sol's point of, it's a question of what do you want to do in Dynamo? Figure out how to do that before generative design comes into the question. Make that happen once and then figure out how to sort of flex it for generative. And you don't have to learn any C sharp. I don't really know any. I mean, I can read a little, but I've never really written my own. You don't need Python. You can get by using content that's been published by the larger Dynamo community for the most part. So focus on sort of out of the box first, then branch into Python as you find you might have the need, or branch into zero touch nodes with C sharp as the need comes through. But I've got some, you know, we're partnered with customers to build some amazingly powerful graphs without having to get really into Python or C sharp. So it's totally doable without having to reinvent the wheel, so to speak, at this point.
Okay, so I just learned something that is C sharp. I looked at it from a music perspective, but there I learned something new today as well. So thank you for clarifying that for me. All right. This one I think maybe Sol can answer. View asks, hello, how is the workflow of working between Dynamo or Revit and Grasshopper and Rhino? I find Revit is still not good for kind of organic modeling.
Right, very good question. Very interesting question that crops up again and again with in different kind of flavors, in different kind of ways. So what we would say is there are different ways to, first of all, connect Rhino to Revit. There's different ways to connect Rhino to Dynamo. And so you can use, if that is your sort of modeling tool of choice, you can definitely use content that comes in from that space inside of the Revit ecosystem. And a lot of people do, and they use Interop through Dynamo to do that. There's also other things out there on the marketplace that enable you to do it as well. So what I'd also say is that Dynamo also enables you to do some of this organic modeling inside of Revit as well. So if you don't want to purchase Rhino or you don't have access to that, you can definitely do some more organic modeling within the Dynamo ecosystem. The angle from that really is more coming in from a sort of more programmatic viewpoint as opposed to sort of a push-pull or a direct modeling application. And you could look into using Format, for example, as well, if you wanted to get some more sort of expression when it comes to push-pull stuff. But Dynamo definitely enables you to do that, and there are interop capabilities between sort of both pieces of software.
Great, thank you. And the next question also saw from Asia is, what is CLI? Can you kind of expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. Very good question. So CLI stands for the command line interface. Basically, you can think of the CLI when it comes to the Dynamo ecosystem as being all that Dynamo can do without you seeing it. So it's kind of like the engine or the execution of a graph in the background without you being able to actually open up a window and see what's going on and interact with Dynamo in that kind of way. So you don't get to sort of build a graph inside of the CLI. You only get to really run a graph and specify a few different things. So we say there's a difference between what we say headed, which has a head, which in this case is like a UI. So you get to see things, to engage with it, to interact with it, versus headless. And so the CLI is the headless expression of Dynamo. And GD actually utilizes the CLI or an expression of the CLI to do a lot of its work.
Okay. And I assume this is a follow-up to that question. How do we convert a flowchart into, I believe it's supposed to be pseudocode?
Right. I'm assuming flowchart here is something like a process map. So what I personally like to do inside of this space is if I have a really complex graph, if it's a simple one, I'll just jump into Dynamo and start playing with it, noting that sometimes that takes me down sort of twists and turns that potentially loses me time, but I'm okay with that. And if there's a complex graph, I'll typically process map that. So start to understand where I want to start, where I want to end, and figure out the steps to get there. So to figure my way through that, the maze of that problem. In terms of turning into pseudocode, you could start taking that flowchart and actually building that inside of Dynamo. So I do this with code blocks sometimes. So I just mock up the sort of the pieces of the puzzle, the steps that I want to do, and start replacing those with different nodes as I start to understand in my own head exactly what's going on. So I might have a code block saying, I want to get these kind of inputs, and a code block at the end saying, I want to get these kind of outputs. And then I have to step through that in the same way you do a process map, but do that actually inside of Dynamo. We can start to push and pull different pieces by replacing nodes and understanding the flow of data through them.
Great. Thank you, Sol. There was a question that came through about Revit and asking when we'll make a normal family browser in Revit. I'm not sure. I think normal is a relative term, but we have updated the family browser in Revit. It came out in 2021.1 and also, of course, in the latest 2022 release. And just so you know, since we're on the Revit topic, I absolutely love Revit, of course. We are going to be continuing these Ask Me Anything sessions, so look for those Revit-specific sessions coming up. All right. I'm not sure, maybe Lily can take this one. Jacob actually marked this one. One generative design I would like to see practical is model optimization, like export from different format with polygon optimization.
Okay, so polygon optimization in terms of trying to get sort of the right meshing is a really, really complex topic. One thing, like if that was to come across my desk, later this afternoon or tomorrow morning, the first thing that I would do is load up the DynaShape package, which is sort of a physics solver inside of Dynamo, which will allow you to sort of optimize in terms of consistency pretty easily that way. So you don't have to get into sort of the generative design directly. However, that does work, or I guess I should say has been made to work inside generative design. So it's definitely something that can be a springboard into sort of the multi-objective optimization line that you might have with that. You know, maybe it's not just sort of form, but it's also solar radiation gains or something along those lines.
One other thing on that, it's, you know, kind of trying to sort of read between the lines on these questions. If you've got a smooth surface and you're trying to sort of turn it into a polygonal model and bring it into something else, shout out to Mesh Toolkit, which is a package that's available straight through Dynamo, which I'm assuming a workflow, something like you've got a smooth thing, you want to turn it into a faceted thing, and what's a good way to do that? So there is a workflow where you can reference something like a SAT file or geometry in Revit. You can bring it in, turn it into a mesh. And then there's a whole bunch of tools for mesh optimization. And I'm going to get the terminology wrong that is used in Mesh Toolkit, but there's basically smoothing and there is sort of relaxation tools and decimation tools and sort of simplification. So you can go from a very dense mesh to a very thin mesh, and then you can make all the triangles as much like each other as you want. And, you know, basically there's like four nodes used in conjunction with each other that you can really fine tune what that mesh is like. And then that mesh can become, you know, your polygonal model that you want to deal with. So again, there are tools out there to sort of deal with things like polygonal mesh optimization.
Great. Well, we're coming up on the end of the hour, and I'm not seeing any more questions coming in. So I have one more for each of the panelists, and we'll go around. If you could create anything using generative design, what would it be? So Saul, why don't we start with you?
I personally like using both Dynamo and GD just to play with form. So it's more of an artistic front, similar to what Zach has on the back of his screen. And I just like expressions of color and form and figuring out like what generates joy in me. This is more of a, less of a work oriented thing and more of a personal one.
Awesome. Zach?
The open-ended question is, I don't make buildings in my spare time, but I do pottery in my spare time, as you can see from my background, as Saul sort of talks about. And the reason that pottery, I think, is relevant to the discussion, actually, is because, you know, throwing vessel forms it's a constrained process and it has certain rule systems that are in place. And it's the same kind of logic, albeit in a simplified state, to look at something like pottery as an optimized or a generative process. You take your constraints, you figure out how to work with them, you figure out what success looks like, and you create outcomes. So.
Awesome. Thank you, Zach. Lily, do you have an architectural answer for us?
I am really excited about the opportunities for involving more environmental design analysis tools in our generative processes, because it is something that we really, really need to focus on as we're building all these buildings that we're going to need to be building in the coming years. And, you know, whether they come from SpaceMaker or whether they're tools that we have so many analysis tools inside of Autodesk. And I think we really need to figure out better ways to harness them and use them in different contexts. And I think that's a really, really exciting prospect for Autodesk. And I really hope that we can move into that area more, whether you're doing kind of the one-off study to give you a number on some environmental factor or, you know, energy analysis, carbon, embodied carbon analysis, really, really important. Or if you're doing it in a generative way and, you know, making hundreds of designs that you can compare the embodied carbon use and energy use of, for one example.
Great. And Jacob, do you want to go ahead and finish that? We did get one more question in. But Jacob, you've got Quidditch behind you. What else could there be?
I mean, I tend to go all over the place with this, right? Like, I've solved how to pick a wheelchair up and put it into a back of a car. I've done Quidditch World Cup. I've laid out the care of magical creatures, OWL. I think the limits are pretty much endless. But personally, right now, I've picked up some new drinkware, like glasses and stuff, and I need to rearrange my cabinets. And I've tried this manually like 600 times, and I always wind up after the fact going, doesn't all fit. Oh. So I'm probably going to try a graph to sort of optimize, because I'm not just optimizing the layout of the cups inside the cabinet, but also the shelves. And then the other one I have is I'm looking, my family's actually looking at maybe doing an addition on their place up in New Hampshire. So I'm sort of wondering if I could implement some fun stuff there to capitalize on the good views as opposed to just do what is simple, right? So
that's a great idea.
If I do either, maybe I'll post a little bit about them.
Awesome. So one last question, and Jacob, maybe you can take this one too. Where can we get exercises or challenges to work out our skills in Dynamo or generative design?
This is a great question. I get it all the time. I think we've been posting the link to all the resources, but what I recommend, don't dive straight into generative design if you don't yet have a good understanding of Dynamo, in particular the geometry engine, if you're trying to solve geometric problems. Generative design might have gone a little bit too far too fast. So we start with the Dynamo primer, build up some basic sort of skill sets there. Skip nothing, go through every exercise, even if you're like, I do interior design, I'm never going to have to lay solar panels out on a roof. Well, if you skip that, you won't understand what it means to use cross-product lacing, you won't get those panels laid out in the right way. And then when it comes time to laying out desks in a room, it's not quite going to, you're going to have a big hurdle to get over, right? So don't skip anything, go through all the exercises. When you're done with that, then go into the generative design primer, go all the way through the generative design primer and generativedesign.org, and then start your sort of first from scratch, want to do this on my own graph. And then when it comes time, lean hard on the Dynamo community. Go to the forum, ask. When you ask, please provide a data set. Half my life is spent rebuilding somebody else's data set. So give me a sample RVT or an Excel file or something like that when you post to the Dynamo BIM forms, and the community will certainly help you out.
Okay. And one last real quick question. I believe Lily could probably take this one. It might be complicated, but is it possible to do a plan and space layout study in the generative design package, like the optimal layout on a hospital floor to optimize accessibilities, et cetera?
I don't know if I can answer that in 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
I mean, I would say yes, definitely possible. Start with looking at what goals you're going to be after in this study, and specifically what goals and how are you going to measure them? And then make a list of like 8 possible outcomes that you want to measure. Then make a list of 8 possible inputs that you want to, that are important to vary. Like, where is the nurse or the headquarter desk located, or where is a certain door located, or how are these rooms laid out? But keep it to like, you know, 8 things, and then try to start building that the workflow of how your logic is going to work. And then you can start building from there and start studying. I will say Jacob's advice is good. Get it working once in Dynamo and then start to get into automating it many, many times in generative design. Right. And also we'd love to see what you do. So post about it, ask questions, and keep in touch.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, as we wrap up, I want to thank everyone for attending today's Ask Me Anything. Thank you to our product team for answering all those questions, for David and Aaron for fielding those questions. Look for more Ask Me Anything sessions coming up in the very near future. Have a great day, everyone.